Substance Designer 14.1 is fresh out of the oven, and the spline family just got bigger with the arrival of a new node, the Scatter Spline on Spline. So let's talk about it. Just in case you forgot, right now in Designer you can draw splines and scatter patterns along them. This works similarly to the tile sampler. You plug your custom patterns in, and then the scatter will place them along your splines. With the current release, you can go even further than that by scattering splines on splines, and then use those generated splines to scatter even more splines or new patterns. If your head isn't spinning yet, let's dive into practical use cases to see how it all works. We can start with a very simple example, just to ease ourselves into this new way of working. One of the first things that comes to mind when thinking about splines on splines is fractal structure. And the snowflake is a great example of that, so I made this piece of jewelry as an experimental project. And here, let me remind you that all the projects I'm going to present are fully available for download. Just check the link in the description box. We try to make them as easy to explore as possible with comments and navigation pins so that you can really learn from them at your own pace. And this time, we also put together a graph with some choice tidbits, cool use cases, happy accidents, interesting effects that we wanted to share with you. We would love to know what you think about this, if you find it useful, and if you'd like to have more content like that in the future. So please let us know in the comments. All right, back to work. So I have a basic spline setup here, just three splines placed at an angle that makes up a half snowflake. What we can now do is grow new splines on this structure. So let's jump into it by bringing in the scatter spline on spline and have a little walkthrough. All right, notice that it has two spline inputs. The first one is for the parent spline, which is the spline you want to scatter upon. In our case, that's our main setup here. The second one is for the children's spline, that is the spline you want to be scattered. You can leave this one empty if you don't have a custom spline to scatter, and this is what we're gonna do for now. Okay, let's have a look inside the node. And to make things clear, I'm going to scroll down to the very bottom and enable the background preview. Just make things a bit easier to understand. All right, let's start from the top. The first thing you get to choose is the side your splines are scattered on. So you have left, right, both, alternate, and random. Let's go with left and right. You can obviously choose how many splines you want. In this case, we can stick with 8. The start and end sliders are very handy because they let you trim the distribution range. So you see here the center is a bit cluttered. So to fix this, I'm just going to push the start slider a little to the right, just so that it clears out this area. Okay, we'll go over the remaining parameters in a bit. Next, we have the size parameters. Pretty self-explanatory, but they let you achieve very interesting effects. For instance, at the bottom, we have an option to scale down based on the parent spline start and end. Again, direction matter. So if I go back to my first spline and flip it, see, the effect gets inverted. Now, that effect is nice, but it's not exactly what I want. What I want is for the splines to get bigger around the center and to shrink down towards the ends. I want some sort of spike in the center. And how can I do that? Well, it appears that we have a scale map multiplier just like in a tile sampler. Things work a little bit differently with splines because you get to choose between two different sampling modes. Now, what is a sampling mode? It may sound complicated, but it's actually very simple. Texture space works like in a tile sampler. It superimposes the texture over the whole X to Y space. Horizontal mode, however, samples one line of the image for each spline. You can think of it as if it was unfolding the spline horizontally and picking up the values as it goes. Knowing that, we can assume that a simple mirrored gradient will work. So let's try it. Rotate it. And there we go. Let's just add some randomness to the mix. Okay. Next, we have the position settings. Nothing new here. You can move your splines along the tangent, along the normal, get offset along the spline, and randomize all this. Now, the rotation section is quite important because when you scatter splines on both sides, you can tweak the angle like so, which already gives a more snowflakey look. And if you switch the mode to absolute, you can rotate the splines independently from the parent spline, which, as a side note, is just incredible to make northern lights, but let's close that digression. All right, I think we have a satisfying base for this snowflake, so let's just finish it. All that is left to do is to add these ending arrows at the tips. And that's actually a good exercise. If you've been following along, why don't you pause the video and try to guess the next step, just putting into practice what I just showed you. All right, let's do it quickly together. To get this effect, we need another scatter spline on spline, and we can actually duplicate this one, hook our secondary splines to it, and Okay, we obviously have too many splines. We only want one pair at each end. So what I'm going to do is first reduce the amount to one, then push the start slider. But you see, when I go to the max, they seem to disappear before they reach the actual end of the splines. And that's because we're still using that gradient to scale them down. So let's fix this quickly in the size section, toning down the randomness. All right, we can finally bring all these splines together using append nodes, because at this stage, they're still separate. So this one, and this one, then this one, and this one. All right, you can deactivate the direction arrows if they get in the way. Okay. And last but not least, we can render everything using a spline render node. A small caveat here, unless you're plugging something in the background, this node will default to 8 bits. So to avoid any further bending issues, I'm going to manually switch it to 16 bits. And that's it. You now have a half snowflake that you can reform using mirrors. What is great about this setup is that it is very easy to iterate on. Since we have some randomness, we can play with the seed, we can move around the branches, change the amount. It's really versatile. Okay, let's move on to a more advanced project, this embroidered tree. Now, there's a lot going on here, but you'll notice that in reality, everything revolves around these two phases. Each orange frame corresponds to a level of splines. So we have the primary splines here, then the secondary, then the tertiary, and finally the last splines that make up the leaves. But this is just the structure, the skeleton. To turn that into a fully fleshed embroidery, we need to render these splines, and this is what the green frames are for. Each spline gets its own treatment. I use different textures for each level. So here I have classical silver threads, here I have sequins, and for the leaves I used simple threads. Now we're not going to redo this whole embroidery, but we can create its structure together to see how you can really harness the power of the scatter splines on splines. And again, you can take all the time you want to examine the graph. Alright, where does it all start? Well, you see that we have this block here that drives all the other splines, so this is going to be our beginning. I duplicated it on the side so that we can start from here. This time, everything that I'm going to show you will be previewed through a regular scatter on spline. If you reduce the shape distance to zero, you get that nice ribbon, and it's just a convenient way to preview both thickness and height at the same time. Now, just a few words about the setup itself. I'm actually reusing the exact same base as for the snowflake. See, we have the three main branches here. But I made a few adjustments to give us a head start and make them more organic and tree-like, so to speak. First, I added some thickness using a sample thickness node, which basically lets you drive your spline thickness with a map. That's super handy because here you can widen the base with just a gradient. Perfect. The second thing I wanted to address after assembling everything is the height. By default, those three splines share the same height, right? They all come from the same source here, and it might cause intersection issues down the line. So to prevent that, I randomize their height by running them through a sample height node. The sample height does the same thing as the sample thickness. It lets you change the property through a map. The trick here is to switch the mode to random horizontal and drive it with an anisotropic noise so that each spline inherits the value of a different line. Very handy and very easy to randomize too. And finally, to break that very straight look, I used a spline warp with a purlin to get soft distortions. So this here, all this is going to be our primary splines, out of which all the rest will flow. All right, we're now ready to scatter some branches on that structure. Let's add a scatter spline on spline, and this time take things a bit further. Let's switch to alternate and trim both ends a little to begin with. Alright, time to have some fun and try out the custom spline mode. I'm going to add a polyquadratic spline and connect it to the custom spline slots. There we go. Now, a few words about the custom spline, or as I call it, the children's spline. By default, its global position and rotation do not matter. So you see, if I add a 2D transform here, it has no effect whatsoever. That's because the spline position is set to a long spline by default, which will automatically snap it into place. If you toggle that to absolute, then you can use the 2D manipulator to place it wherever you want. It can get quickly complicated, however, so I would recommend keeping the default settings unless you have a specific need for that. And you can also play with the pivot point for more precision, but again, most of the times you won't have to worry too much about these settings. Obviously, it gets interesting when we start moving points around. Like so. And as I do that, the spline's rotation also changes because it's based on the first point tangents. And so you can clearly see it happening if I mess with the beginning of the spline. All right, so all I want is a simple curve. Something like that, maybe. All right, now you see that yes, our children's spline is scattered on both sides, but the orientation is not mirrored. And to fix this, you just need to enable symmetry. And we now have a good basis that we can refine to make it look more natural, randomizing the scale. Also going to reuse the gradient texture to taper the ends. Okay, next there's a few interesting sliders that can help us in the position section. You can randomize the offset. And if you want to sync your children's spline with the parent's spline thickness, you can do so using the offset by thickness parameter. This is useful if you want your splines to rest on the surface of the parent spline, so to say. And let me actually just preview the rendered result. See? And if I change the thickness here, the offset will adjust itself accordingly so that my splines are always neatly placed. Now let's move on to the rotation parameters. We already covered most of them, but there's one we haven't talked about, and it's the rotation map parameter. We don't really need it for branches, but let me just demonstrate what it does on another setup. So I'm plugging the same gradient in the rotation map input, and I have it set to horizontal mode. And if I push the slider, here we go. As you can see, it's the same behavior than in a tile sampler. Where the map is white, the rotation is maximal, and vice versa. And interestingly, if I push the contrast to the max, I can use it to flip certain splines like so. Very useful, and we actually put this example in the tidbits graph that I mentioned earlier, so go check it out. And note that you can also affect the symmetry itself if you want to. Now back to our branches. They're almost done, but there are still two sections I want to walk you through because they can look a little bit complex at first. I'm talking about the height and thickness sections. The reason we have these is because we're combining two sets of splines, each with their own thickness and height data, and we need to be able to control how they both interact with one another, right? So let's focus on the height first. As you can see on the render here, by default, the children's splines inherit their height from their parent, which is what you want in most cases, just having them at the same level. Now let's have a look at the sliders we have to change that. First, you see that we get the same controls twice, once for the start and once for the end of the spline. So it may look like a lot of options, but it's actually just those three parameters that you can adjust for each end. The mode at the top is set by default to from parent spline plus custom spline. Now what does that mean exactly? If you're ever unsure about what a parameter does, now is the time to remind you that they all have detailed tooltips to guide you. So here, if I just hover over there, we can read that this mode uses the height of the parent spline, then adds the custom spline height to it. In other words, it acts like an additive blend. If I start pushing the slider, you see that the height from my custom spline, which, remember, is at 1 by default, is slowly adding itself to the base height. If I push it too far, the accumulated heights start to hit the range limit, creating this clipping in my render. So when using it, really keep in mind that it is adding and not multiplying. As for the offset slider, it just helps you adjust the result from that first slider. The two other modes are pretty simple. Manual just switches to absolute values, so you get one slider for each end. And from custom spline keeps the custom spline height without adding it to the parent's height. In our case, we can stick with the default mode, and if we want the children's splines to be tucked under, we can always input a negative value or a positive one if we want them to stick out more. Alright, what about the thickness? Well, it works more or less the same way. We get two sets of options, one for each end, and by default, the children's spline inherit their thickness from the parent. See, this spline here is thinner than this one here. The only difference with the height is that the two values are not added to one another. Here you just go from the parent thickness to a zero. So when the slider is at 1, the thickness is fully inherited from the parent, and when you set it to 0, you remove that information, so my splines completely disappear. For our branches, I think a slight tapering would be nice. Something like that. And then it's just a matter of adjusting everything, warping a little, and we get a nice set of secondary branches. From there, you can just reapply the same logic for each new set of spline. Just add another scatter splines on splines, pick the splines you want to grow them from, and play with the parameters, which is what I did for this third set of branches here. And just to finish off, I'd like to show you the settings for my fourth set of spline, which correspond to the leaves in my embroidery. Surprisingly, you'll notice that it's just a bunch of straight spline that I scattered about the ends. There's no curve or anything. The secret here was to play with the thickness only. My custom spline may be straight, but it has some thickness in the middle, creating this leaf shape. Then, in the scatter spline on spline, I toggled the thickness mode to custom spline so that the children will just keep their own thickness without being affected by the parent thickness. And that's it! Using a regular scatter, I was able to use that thickness to embroider these nice leaves. And this concludes our exploration of the scatter spline on spline. I hope you're excited by all the possibilities that this node opens, and we really look forward to see what you create with it.